Video Killed the Radio Star presents the music videos of the Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin. In this episode, we talk to directors Brian Grant, Andy Morahan and Jay Dubin about the mishaps and traumas behind Aretha's duet with George Michael and the classic video for Freeway of Love.
All this time, I couldn't shake your memory.
I think what you have to understand about Aretha Franklin is she's almost the definition of soul music. They call her the Queen of Soul because she almost created it. She took the church, she takes all of that gospel and she turns it into soul music. She turns it into this fantastic evocation of the new, emergent, strident Black America.
And I'm calling, calling.
In the 60s and 70s, particularly the records that she made for Atlantic back then, defined soul music. People now talk about the great diva singers. Aretha invented that. Aretha's voice knocked down boundaries. She crossed all of those boundaries. There'd been plenty of great Black American singers before her, the Mahalia Jacksons, the Billie Holidays, but Aretha broke through. She came through in the 60s at the same time as civil rights. She came through at the time when Black America is reaching out of the ghettos, and she knocked down those walls with the sheer strength of her vocal abilities.
Acting crazy, always laughing when I'm mourning, 'cause I knew you need me.
Everybody had Aretha's greatest hits where I lived. You heard it blasting out of council houses. It was everywhere. And also she defined that ability, those voice that could swoop through the octaves, that could take you on that emotional journey. She's massive in terms of her voice, but also incredible in terms of her ability to reach your soul.
Now work with quite a number of big acts. I get sent a single called Freeway of Love, and it's by Aretha Franklin, who I've been a fan of since I was 15 or 16, because I loved Tamla Motown and Atlantic in the 60s. It's a fantastic record, really fantastic. Now, if you work with Aretha Franklin, you have to go to Detroit. She's not going anywhere. She's the Queen of Soul. You have to go there. So on the plane, I wrote this kind of Pied Piper story set in Detroit, Motor City. I thought, what about if she's working in a car factory, and what she does is she sings this song and kind of leads the car workers out like a Pied Piper.
Will you be a vision in white?
So everybody likes the idea. I get Arlene to come with me to choreograph it. We managed to persuade the Ford Motor Company to give us a car factory because it's Aretha and she lives there.
Life of Brian was always fun. No, life with Brian was always fun. And it was always last minute. I got a call, can I go to Detroit? I'm just sitting at home one night and can I go to Detroit? And of course, it's always last minute. It was extraordinary coming into Detroit because it was, as then, a city that was falling apart.
I was shocked at the state Detroit was in, and I just said, Aretha, you know, man, you don't have to live here. Why you live here? And she said, it was my home.
Part of the video was that we were going to shoot in car shops, in breakers' yards, in different places, on cars, in cars, lots of little vignettes, little shots that could be done here, there and everywhere. So we worked really hard.
The idea was the next day we're going to go into the car factory and Aretha's going to turn up and do that bit. That night she calls and says, I don't want to do it, and says, I don't want to do the video. And I was shell-shocked, absolutely shell-shocked. No idea why this happened, she just decided she didn't want to do it.
Down, yeah. She didn't want to go out into anywhere where she could see the sky, day or night, which meant she didn't want to come out of her house, and she certainly didn't want to work in a car junkyard.
I remember going to the hotel and sitting in the hotel and watching the sun go down and thinking, I can't leave Detroit without an Aretha Franklin video because I'm never going to come back here again. I phoned the record producer, which is a guy called Narada Michael Walden. I just wanted to sort of get some advice as to how I could persuade Aretha to come and do this. He was fantastic. Not only did he give me advice, he said, stay where you are. And he got on a plane and he brought Clarence Clemons from the E Street Band with him. And we went up to, because he played on the single, we went up to Aretha's house, we sat in Aretha's house, and he kind of persuaded her that she should really do this video.
Finally, I think after 2 days, she came out and coming out of the house, you know, covered so she couldn't see the sky, and the whole location had to change because she had to be indoors. So she was in a nightclub.
So we set it up in this place called Club Taboo, which Aretha owned, and we shot. We shot it really quickly, probably shot it in about 3 or 4 hours. And the last thing I wanted to do is, in Detroit, there's a place called Hitsville. And I thought, I want to put myself in this video somehow. I've been a fan of Tamla Motown since I was a kid. And Hitsville is where there's a little recording studio in a house in Detroit where everybody who was anybody had recorded the Four Tops, Temptations, Marvin Gaye. They'd all recorded there, Stevie Wonder. So I got myself in front of this place and I did 2 lines from the song, and it's in the video, so I'm in a video with Aretha Franklin. We got all the footage back to London and I started to look at it, and what I had was footage of a performance, footage of dancers in Detroit, and no way of sort of connecting them, really. So I got somebody to get me some stock footage. I went into an editing room by myself and I sat there for 3 days and just cut it. Just literally made it up. And it was a success. I mean, it just proves sometimes that sometimes you don't have a plan and some good things arise. Well, it was in black and white because I'd shot it in colour, but the stock footage was in black and white, and putting them together just didn't work. So we thought, well, we'll turn it all into black and white. And that's kind of how it melded together. Top of the Pops wouldn't play it because it was in black and white, and they told me, the BBC said you can't put black and white clips on because you paid for a colour licence. when it became a hit, they changed their mind and put it on. So.
These calls to meet John Lennon or meet, and you know, it didn't really light my fire at first because I didn't have posters of them on my walls when I was a kid. But when I went to meet Aretha, I met her in a house in suburban Detroit. Aretha had a phobia of flying. She and even trains, to the most part, she wouldn't leave Detroit. So you have to, you know, you had to go to the mountain, so to speak. Now you had to drive through about an hour of burned out city to get to a house. I'm talking, this was Dresden after the firebombing. I couldn't believe what Detroit looked like. I got there in a house, but it was a Friday night. She was there with some members of a local church, and they were serving fried chicken. And they broke out into song, I mean, gospel song. And I'm sitting there, and I'm going to myself, holy crap, I'm sitting here in Aretha Franklin's house in Detroit singing gospel songs with her. And I never sung a song in my life. I mean, that's when it all hit me. Wow. I mean, wow. It was just amazing. Oh, I can get through another night. It's only another night.
thing about Aretha as well is she comes from that gospel background, and there's lots of jazz in there too. She started out as a jazz singer. So she's used to improvising. She's used to feeling the spirit and just letting it come out, which makes her a fantastic live performer. Apparently, it meant she wasn't very good at lip-syncing to her videos, because she wasn't used to doing that. She did the song differently every time. She let the spirit take her.
I remember another profound thing, during the filming with Aretha. All of a sudden, I get a call from the record company. And the fellow on the other side, I believe it was Len Epan at the time, just didn't know what to say. And it turned out that the Space Show had blown up. And Aretha and I, the crew, everyone, we immediately turned the TV on, and we saw the explosion of the space shuttle, and all seven folks were gone. And I remember Aretha, you know, just sort of sat down, and she led a little prayer. She just led a little prayer for them, which I thought was quite interesting.
One of the things about Aretha is she's not just recognized as the Queen of Soul, she's unchallenged as the Queen of Soul. There are other great singers, but no one came close.
I ain't no psychiatrist, I ain't no doctor with Greek. It don't take too much high cue to see what you're doing to me.
She had a brother, Clarence, and he wore a bit of a hat, and he was sort of something, a character out of Superfly, fancied himself a player. So we're on the set, and Clarence was getting a bit large. Every 2 minutes he was interrupting, jumping in front of the camera. Aretha needs this, my sister needs that, Aretha needs this, Aretha needs that, no, no, no. Putting his 2 cents in, change the camera angle, change that. So I went up to Aretha and I said, give me a little leeway here. I'm gonna deal with your brother. She said, what are you gonna do? I said, just, you know, I'm gonna pull something out of the air. Just go with it.
You need me, and I need you. Without each other, ain't nothing we can do. Yeah, think about a bee.
What's trying to do with me?
To the bone.
So next take, told the cameraman, told the crew. So he jumps in front of the camera, starts yelling. I pick up a grip stand. I start smashing glasses on tables, which was a setup, of course, and yelling, I can't work like this. I can't work like this. You're destroying the creative moment. And Aretha's laughing her ass off and eating a Big Mac off the side. And he's just apologizing. And then Aretha finally said, now, Clarence, you know, go home. We don't need you here. And I was crapping in my pants because, this guy had a gun. You know, afterwards somebody said to me, the guy could have shot you. And I didn't think about it.
There's something about, you know, working with iconic artists, about simply capturing what's iconic about them. I kind of worked out the Jumbotron screen idea with George. You know, we kind of led it creatively, and she was happy to turn up and do her bit.
Like a warrior that fights and wins the battle, I know the taste of victory.
The difference was, I mean, he arrived with his manager and his makeup artist and me, basically into Detroit. And she lives in Detroit and turned up with 6 limos and 40 people. So she's, you know, really old school kind of like, you know, big superstar from a bygone era, and her brother, the Reverend Cecil Franklin, was like, you know,
saying, do we get cash for this? Do we get cash for this?
And we're going, no, that doesn't work like that in videos and stuff. I mean, they were fun, but it was, you know, she liked to snack all day and smoke all day, and you'd often see her with a kind of spare rib in one hand and a menthol cigarette in the other hand. So it was quite an eye opener, actually. The weird thing about her, though, it was very difficult to get her to look at George. Because she, you know, she used to being on stage, and she would perform to her people. So if I wanted to get the correct eye line, or let's say I wanted to get them to look more towards each other, I'd have to ask all her people to kind of over George's shoulder. It was bizarre. It's the most bizarre thing, you know. Even though she knew she was doing a duet, she was like playing out to an audience. I know George was a bit frustrated, but that she wouldn't engage with him as such, you know what I mean? I think she knew he had a great voice and he was on the cusp of being, you know, a great famous singer. I mean, you know, she's quite savvy in herself. I don't think she'd have done the duet with this guy if she hadn't known, you know, or someone said, you know, you should be doing it, this guy's going to be the biggest thing, and, you know what I mean? She was very friendly and all that, but she just, he found it hard that she, you know, it's almost like she was expected to, you know, to perform to her people rather than kind of engage with him as they're performing. And that was a little bit frustrating. George was quite particular at that stage of his career about what kind of shots and angles he wanted of himself. You know, so I think we just pieced it together, and people have said to me over the years, oh, you never shot them. They were never in the same room, were they? It wasn't until I kind of revisited that. But I can see that, and I can see what you're saying. But they definitely were together. But it makes it look progressive that we were holding that back to the end. Wasn't deliberate, I can assure you.
Being aware that by the 1980s, you're dealing with an artist who first appeared 20 years before that. Not that she's not still a great singer. She can still make records as good as Freeway of Love. She's still such a great singer that someone like George Michael demands to go and sing with her. But we are looking at an artist who's dealing here with technologies that are new to her. She's already the queen on the throne. And she's having to kind of deal with all this video stuff. So no wonder she plays up a bit. It's a mixture of jazz and gospel and our old-time R&B, and you've got soul. And it is embodied in Aretha Franklin. Aretha's voice is a message in and of itself. You can't listen to her without feeling the kind of the power and the passion and all that. It's got those cadences of Martin Luther King, of the great preachers. It's all in there. That's why it gets to you.
At work, God, just take me some time.
She took the music of the ghettos of America and made it so that every young mod in London thought she was singing to and about him. That this was music that suddenly went global on the strength of her voice. It's a sound that reaches deep inside you. It's a sound that makes you want to dance. It's a sound that makes you want to holler. It took all of that black American experience and sent it global. She became the defining icon of her music and almost of a generation. She was Black America's voice. She was its queen. Not just the queen of soul music, almost the queen of a people. Made it possible for all the Whitneys and all the Warblers that have come since. She was just the best. They called James Brown the godfather of soul. Well, she's the godmother, and she's the godmother of Whitney, which kind of is fantastic. It sort of fits in. Black American male soul singers, you've got contenders. Some would go for Otis Redding. Some would go for Marvin Gaye. You may get the real outsiders going for Donny Hathaway. Perhaps James Brown, the kind of the funk master. Aretha is all of those. She really doesn't have a contender. You can argue for Otis or Marvin, but you can't argue against Aretha. I think the way that you can judge Aretha's musical legacy is that any young pretenders, particularly any great female singers who come along now, any youngsters, will be judged against her. But not only that, they will learn from her if they've got any wisdom whatsoever. Because to this day, and I suspect forever, she will be the Queen of Soul.